You're listening to MCS Live, the best of Lowell sports and beyond on MillCitySports.com.
Welcome to our debut episode of Mill City Sports MCS Live Faceoff. We have UMass Lowell facing Michigan State University tonight at 7 o'clock here at the Tsongas Center. I'm joined by my co-host, Greg Celona.
Yeah, not sick this week, so hopefully I can be coughing.
No coughing fit. That's great. And at some point, we'll probably be joined by Bob Ellis, the play-by-play host of the UMass Lowell Riverhawks on ESPN Radio, as well as Shawn Hutcheon of the Lowell Sun. He also writes for the Fourth Period magazine. Covering the Boston Bruins. He'll be here at some point. We got Greg for a while. Greg also is a student assistant here for the UMass Lowell Riverhawks. So he'll at some point probably be called upon to get the Riverhawks in gameplay and set and do some stat stuff tonight. So maybe we'll do some play-by-play, like little kids playing hockey on the ice right now. But we're live from the Tsongas Center here at UMass Lowell in Lowell, Massachusetts.
If anything, it just gives you a good atmosphere.
Yeah.
If you can
hear the whistles in the background and stuff like that. We'll be here live with you from 5 p.m. till 6:30. Puck drop starts at 7 o'clock against Michigan State University. It's our first time visiting the Tsongas Center, first time in Lowell in their history of their hockey program and Lowell's hockey program. So we have a bunch of stuff to talk about tonight, as well as last night's disappointing loss, 8-4 loss to Michigan. It was very lopsided, I guess you'd say. Michigan was through a goal, UMass Lowell was through a goal, back and forth game. We'll talk about that. We'll talk about the preview of tonight's game, which is against, again, the Michigan State University Spartans. Yeah. A little bit of a gap there. And then we'll talk a little bit about maybe some alumni. We'll hit maybe on some Bruins when Sean shows up. That will be nice to talk about. Yeah, so it's the hockey show in general, but we'll talk about a bunch of things. But we'll start out with talking about a little bit of last night. Very disappointing loss. UMass Lowell went into Michigan last year and came out with a squeaked out a win, 2-1. It was a cool win last year, a very nice win last year. It was a very appreciative win last year.
There's one thing that was nice about that trip out there. Many of us who had to stick around here, they actually had both of those games on TV.
Correct.
To see both of them and how the action actually turned out rather than trying to figure out your head on the ball. It was pretty cool to see. They pulled out. That was one of the moments last year when they sort of started out slow. They had the loss to Sacred Heart in the home opener and kind of maybe a wake-up call to start the season. And then they went out to Michigan and won that game, and Michigan was a much higher ranked opponent at that point. So it was like, yeah, we can do this. It was almost opposite that all played out. But that was a good point for them last year. Not a good point in the season for them.
It was not a good game last night. I mean, Kevin Boyle started his fourth game of the season, only 4 games.
Yeah.
It was a little disappointing. Gave up 6 goals. It was a little, again, disappointing for Kevin Boyle this early in the season.
Yeah.
We had a discussion we made it just in time for that. Got stuck talking Riverhawk hockey with a couple of people at the beer works tonight. And one of the things we talked about was the fact that this could have been Kevin Boyle's last. It's hard to say. You guys can't see Greg's expression, but it was a little bit of a different reaction, but it definitely was one of those games that you'd say after the game, Norm said, the reason why he removed Kevin Boyle from the game was because he didn't want to lose him on the draft.
Yeah, true.
And then he thought when he replaced him with Jeff Smith in the second, towards the end of the second period was, and then he said, did you want to leave Kevin Boyle or Jeff Smith on the draft as well?
Yeah.
Forwards and defensemen didn't do their job. Well, the truth of the matter is, Kevin Boyle has been a second-tier goaltender his entire college career. UMass Lowell, or UMass Amherst, and now here at UMass Lowell. That's a Lowell rebound.
Mm-hmm.
It just seems that he's going to be a 900 save percentage goaltender, a little less than that, 95.
A little lower than that first round.
He's going to be that goaltender here if he plays here next to UMass Lowell. So there's a chance that we'll probably see Ole tonight, or maybe Jeff Smith. We don't know for sure. We'll hopefully come in at some point tonight when Pete Storrs and the UMass Wolverhawks bring some stuff in. We'll try to give you some updates on that. But it definitely seems like it's leaning towards it. The freshman will get a shot here pretty soon.
Wouldn't surprise me. Just played about 22 minutes last night, and usually it's almost any level of hockey you see. If your goaltender gives up, Boyle gave up six last night, I believe. If your goaltender's giving up like five or six last night, you're going to want to pull the goaltender out. You don't want to leave the goaltender in there and like let it get even more to their head. I mean, pulling them and like giving them less minutes, it might screw up their goals against average stat line there, but I mean, you've got to get them out of that situation. And like Norm said last night, he felt like the skating were kind of hanging him up. Right? It wasn't their best night, I would agree. I might say that there was a couple that Boyle probably could have stopped, but again, it was a bad situation. And it, like you said, it was a team loss. There was a lot of factors that went into it.
And that's the truth. There's multiple ways to look at it. And Norm might have been correct. Norm, I call him Norm Belichick over the years. It's definitely his secretive way of saying things, but it definitely sounds like he was truthful last night. Maybe he did want to not leave him out to dry. But in the same sense, if Norm didn't think that they probably had a chance of coming back, why not leave him in there?
Yeah.
See if he can persevere. See if he can come back. If they're going to lose, they're going to lose. Why waste a goaltender? Why Jeff Smith gave up two goals later on in the game? Maybe he wouldn't have given up two goals if it was against someone else, started the game or whatever. But it definitely seemed like Norm might have been truthful last night when he said before the team press conference, I didn't want to leave him out to dry.
Yeah.
Replacing the Jeff Smith. And then the same sense, maybe there's an opportunity for Norm to say, look at Jeff Smith at dry.
Yeah, true. Well, we saw in the exhibition game against St. Thomas, every single period had different goaltenders. He started out with Boyle in the first, and then he played Smith and Calagaya in the third period as well. So the only person that had regular season experience was Kevin Boyle. But I was also talking to Bob Ellis about this too. He mentioned that Boyle's the only one that has collegiate hockey experience. So starting out the season, you want to get since he has the most experience, you want to get him in the net first and let the freshman kind of, you know, adjust to the whole speed of the game and watch on the bench a little bit, learn with Norm and the coaches and the practices, right, get prepared before you actually start playing. And you never know, like, this could be the chance that once you pull out of the game, you saw that opportunity and said, you know what, I'm going to get Jeff Smith a little bit of playing time here. This isn't really, it seems like a game that we're probably not going to be able to come back in this, unfortunately. Although, you will say they did battle pretty well, though. Every time that Michigan was up a couple goals, they wound up bringing it back within one. It showed a lot of perseverance in the team. They just weren't able to pull out enough effort to actually get the win and go get ahead of Michigan.
You're right. An opportunity to do that. I mean, the goaltender has for experience. In the same sense, he could have been extreme. It's not like he was a three-year team player that definitely was an opportunity for him to see, you know, an experienced goaltender, but in the same sense, it wasn't like
Correct.
And that's the team. Justin Kimberdell and Evan Campbell both stop in both played their great integrity. One of Hutcheon's teams was community percent of it was definitely nice to see them play and to see them play in the higher level.
Yeah.
So the team in point, both of them are freshmen sitting what, a year and a couple of games.
Yeah.
And they both lead the team points, along with Michael Kaplan, who had 5 points two. Yeah, two goals and three assists.
Yep.
He all three of them, those are sophomores, so we need it's a great thing to see the underclassmen, quote unquote.
True. It's, I mean, you see, you want to see your upperclassmen doing well, too, like your seniors with Zach Cameras and this one. But you're right with you want to see the sophomores pitching in and get, putting up some good numbers, because if you think about it, like, as long as they're not, you know, NHL draftees or they're not getting scouted by so many people, they're definitely going to be a bigger part of the future of the program, too. Because next year they're going to be juniors, they're going to be working their way up into the upper class, and that's when they're going to be heavily relied upon. So at this stage, they're going to start showing some more offensive production and really getting themselves out there.
That was a positive.
Yeah.
See those players. Plus, the fact of the matter is that all the goals of the score for the last night were the first of the season.
Yeah.
So the first game of the season, we saw players like Robert Francis and Jason McGill and Campbell and all the players score multiple points per game. So the repetitive line is the same thing.
Yeah.
It's Terrence Long and Dylan Smith, players like that.
Yeah, Dylan's like his first career goal.
Yeah, so score goals. And to get points on board, it just shows the whole thing. When Long says, bowl style hockey,
not much.
It just shows the whole
not
point.
Much.
Of saying, the whole team can score goals or get assists or have points. Not like a BC West team where it was like one line dominated over everybody else.
Yeah,
not Johnny Gaudreau and Pillar and all the players like that.
Yeah.
The UMass Lowell style hockey has always been, or has been over since normal. The whole team is going to pass on the torch. Their whole team is going to have points and score and things like that.
Yeah,
so that was nice to see last night. There was a couple positives.
Yeah.
Kind of a bad goal, game. For the
this is true. And you mentioned a little about hockey with the aspect that the team is going to be ahead of, like any individual player, like being the one that's heavily relied upon. But last night, if there was one player that you had to pick that stuck out of the game, would just be out of catch. He came back at playing his first game of the season last night. And he had a goal and two assists, led the team in points. I think he might have been the only person that had multiple points.
Mm-hmm.
And he just had an awesome presence in the ice. And, like, you know, I wasn't certain if he came back from injury or, like, what the reason was because he was playing so far. But he was only kind of expecting, you know, his first game of the year. He might be a little bit rusty after coming back, but he, like, looked like he's been playing, you know, for a month.
Mm-hmm.
He was, like, being comfortable on the ice, skating around. He was making some good passes, really good plays. And his goal, picking up, was a really good pass. So it was really cool to see him in his first game really come out. And he seemed to be, like, a much leader on the team. I mean, we talked about world-style hockey being more about the team aspect as a player. But once in a while, you'll see
there
some players
out there
that will be a star in the game, even if they aren't.
Correct. It was nice. I thought about that completely before we got on the air. I talked about that, but added chapter. He comes back from, we don't know what it was. Norm Book made him.
Yeah.
No. But it's definitely something where he wasn't playing. He had 3 games in the season already.
Yep.
He was known as probably going to be one of the top players in the game this year.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think him that definitely, I don't know how to score while he wasn't playing. But it was nice to see him run score. That's pretty cool, but yeah, definitely get to play. large or anything.
Yeah.
You know, but he is a kind of player. It reminds me a little bit of a grab. Reminds me of also like a Marshawn.
Yeah,
I'm going to jab you. I'm going to take him on your ass. I'm not really going to sit down.
UMass Lowell hockey fans, season tickets for the 2014-15 campaign are on sale now. Marquee opponents Boston College, Michigan, Michigan State, and Penn State highlight the home schedule as your Riverhawks look to defend their back-to-back Hockey East championships. Visit GoRiverHawks.com for information on season ticket discounts, benefits, special events, and so much more. Riverhawk Hockey, united in blue.
That was our main favorite, Bob Ellis. We were talking about our hockey preview show a couple weeks ago about Chuck was coming. We had to follow Bob Ellis. Get on the air with us. But we're talking, you know, Riverhawk hockey and a bunch of other stuff tonight. Here at the Tsongas Center. Tickets, I'm guessing, are still available. You probably go to the front door and get the tickets. But I'm sure there's tickets available. The last time was disappointing. That's the first off. And it's that
good. Yep.
Greg would surprise me. It's okay.
At that moment, when you're
just one of those things. Nice to have him back to that game. I'm not even trying to thank you. So, it just was night off. Like, you know, the beer works, it was like all those people there.
Mm-hmm.
In Nebraska, it's about 388 great games, like 10,000 people there, over 10,000 people there.
Those college football teams can even get more than like NFL teams can.
Right.
It's unbelievable.
And it's an unbelievable thing that I keep on saying that I see a crappy college football team. It covers
ESPN,
Fox Sports, all these major outlets.
Yep.
And the best of the best college hockey teams.
Yeah.
And
I mean, it's
like
a couple games on NBC Sports, but maybe.
Right.
Yeah.
That's about it.
As far as national.
It's getting better.
Yeah.
ESPN picks up a bunch of games this year.
Yes, which is pretty cool.
NBC Sports ever has a bunch. CBS Sports has a bunch.
Mm-hmm.
WBIN, the serial, NASA.
Fox Sports gets some regional coverage. I know that, like, if you see, like, some teams in the Midwest, sometimes they get, like, some of the more local channels, almost like that. I mean, that's a great job of showing but it's cool to see them getting a little more national coverage, especially TSN in Canada picking up some, you know, American college hockey teams. I mean, they obviously have a lot of international players that are playing down here, and NHL draft picks that people want to watch, so it's kind of cool to see them.
It is cool, but definitely last idea on that. Opening night, yeah, and it's over
2,000
people in both of them. Does that show nature or the, I mean, it's New England. NASA doesn't have a national channel.
Yeah, this is true.
Your network or, you know, direct TV, you can pick up on the sports site, you pay for the sports site, you can get NASA national. It shows so cool. It's just a cool aspect of it. The whole arena being full. It's not full. I mean, there were empty seats. I can see across from where we're sitting right now in the UMass Lowell press box. That you could see across in section 105 that there were empty seats.
Yeah.
But it was full to an extent where it was like
and there were
pretty
a lot
impressive.
Of people standing around the room in the crowd for us too. It was standing room only.
And it was against Michigan.
Yep.
So there's the name that brings in a lot of fans who maybe not are hockey fans or maybe not UMass Lowell fans that we can say, oh, I like Michigan as a football team, so maybe I'll like them as a hockey team.
Mm-hmm.
And in the same with Boston College.
Yep.
The two highest selling games ever.
Yes.
For Boston College.
Yep.
So there's a little bit of that being so cool to go on. It is definitely that.
Yeah.
But it does show that students actually turn out UCC. They're not missing.
Yes.
And again last night, that section was full.
Yeah, true.
And when the game started and the lady was singing the national anthem and the microphone worked the last night.
Yeah.
It was unbelievable. The crowd screaming. I couldn't talk to the family next to me here in the press box.
Yeah.
On the Eastern River Rock Radio Network. I said, no. Jimmy, what do you think about this? And he's like, what? Like, that says a lot when someone has to ask what you said because of how loud it is in here. It's just a great experience here at UMass Lowell to see that come here. So hopefully the fans turn out tonight. Tonight will be a testament.
Yes.
Personally. Saturday night.
Yep.
After a huge loss.
Mm-hmm.
Against a team that doesn't have as big of a name as Michigan. Michigan State is a little bit less.
It's not a good name in Michigan State. It's still a big school. A lot of people know about it. But it's... In the past, it's always been Saturday games seem to draw a little bit less. It kind of depends on like, what team you're playing, what's happened recently. And it seems that, you know, a lot of students might wind up actually like, leaving campus home on the weekend, so Saturdays are a little bit tougher to draw. So we'll see how it actually turns out.
I hope so, too. If it isn't, I think the game will be well played. It will be a better game than last night. So those who want to come see the game. It should be a great atmosphere, a good game. It's homecoming weekend, so there's stuff going on behind Tsongas Center right now. As you speak.
Yep.
A bunch of things going on tonight. As well as, if you don't want to come, you can watch it on GoRiverHawks.tv, ALC, and you get to watch the game.
I think it's actually free tonight.
That's nice. That's a little way to do it if you're not in the area or you can come watch it on TV. Or you can listen to Bob Ellis and Jimmy Connolly call the game on ESPN River Rock Radio Network. Or WUML. Do you know who the people are on the play-by-play?
I believe Zach Trethaway and James Cherry.
Okay, so the WUML.
91.5.
If you want a little bit non-commercial radio, student radio, it's really good stuff.
Yep.
People like both ways. People like Bob Ellis and Jimmy Connolly. Like student radio. It's really different, but you get both ways. At least we can call the game. That'd be fun.
Yeah, that would be pretty interesting.
But it should be good. We got this pregame show going on here. So that's pretty good.
Yep.
We're on millcitysports.com. If anybody's listening in, that'd be great. We'll also take some questions if anybody wants to tweet at us. You can hashtag MCS Live or tweet at MCS Live. If you have any questions or any comments, yes, MCS Live Radio, you're right. We're just going to MCS Live anymore. I'm Justin Soderberg. This is Celona here. We are the main people for Millcity Sports. get our alumni update coming up tonight. Right, I'm going to see if I've got one from. And also get it all on. Get it all on.
I knew he was overseeing something.
So I looked up the statistics last for the alumni report, which comes out. Again, a new one will come out next Saturday for the home game against UNH. We'll also have a pregame show. We'll have a
Saturday home game. UNH, oh, a new Saturday home game.
We have a pregame show for that show, too, next Saturday at 5 o'clock. But the alumni report, print edition, will be out as well. You can pick up the info table here at the Celona Center or on our website, MCSSports.com. But, yeah, so we did the update last month for David Valvine, first season overseas, but in ECHL for a couple of seasons here in America.
Yeah, Utah Grizzlies.
Yeah, and I think he started with the writing one, but not in the
world. I believe so.
He moved over to Italy. He's a foot citizen already. His citizenship is Italy and North America, or the United States as well. So he goes over to Italy, starts playing, plays in about 5 or 6 games. He has 3 goals, 6 assists, 9 points. Pretty good. That's pretty good. 9 points in 5 games. So now, 24 points on 11 goals and 13 assists, and I believe 11 games.
11 games.
So he doubled his game pretty much. He's tripled his points, roughly. And he's had 5 consecutive games with multiple points. Okay. On October 11th, 3 goals, 2 assists in the same game. 5 points. So he leaves all former Riverhawks with 24 points. And I believe it's 11 games. They're not right in front of him, but I believe it's 11 games.
Yep.
And then right behind him, I believe Soderberg is also playing over the season. I think he's getting number 17 points. So it's nice to see these players playing. More than actually played in North America, so there's a little bit more coverage in that role.
True, you might even have a chance to catch a game if they play anywhere locally.
Correct, but I mean, you can follow them on our website and get their updates and stuff like that on former Riverhawk. Shawn Hutcheon scored his first special point this week.
His first grand.
He had got assisted by former Riverhawk Barry Goes, which is pretty cool.
That's pretty awesome.
That's a cool little stat to have.
It's very good to see them play on the same exact squad, but it's always cool to see teams players on the same team.
Most things after the game, you go, hey, they know where you play.
I mean, we've talked about this before too. It's not like when you talk about bigger programs like Boston College, and even talk about Michigan and like even a bigger school like Wisconsin, Minnesota, where you look around the NHL or like higher tier league in North America and see all these players that are alums from the school. There's so many. Lowell is just now becoming like a more prominent program and like striving towards more success and getting those players that are actually going to be moving on to be playing in those top tier leagues. So when we see a couple of alums in the AHL, the NHL playing, it's a much more cool feeling. It's just more rare.
Yeah, it's nice that Minnesota Wild has pushing forward.
Yep.
And Nashville Predators have started high, but they're having backed up a little bit. Now, played one game out of like what they're 6
True. He played a lot last season because Tech Arena had an injury.
So you'll see him get in the game action here and there, and he did pretty well. I mean, he was awful.
Yeah.
He did pretty well. He actually was the biggest, I believe, goaltender for Nashville to ever hit 20 wins. He had that in the record. He was an all-star goaltender.
Yep.
Hold many records until the school guy named Gunnar Hellebuck came in to play here.
We might be in the NHL.
It's a good point. I mean, it just did an article about he's like waiting for a shot and stuff like that. I mean, you could potentially see Connor Hellebuck. But in the same sense, if we go down that road, Doug Carr excelled at rematch goal. His first goal in the ECHL this season, he gave up 5 goals. Again, one game, it's hard to tell, so on and so forth. But what that asked you was a question, and Greg, I'll ask you that question as well. Does that speak to how well UMass Lowell recruits their defensive core, whether it be defensive forwards or defensive?
I think it does. It's also very kind of difficult to judge because you're facing a lot of different teams when you're at the collegiate level, which is going to be on going up against other college teams. It's a little different than going up against players in the AHL that are they're a little more skilled than most of the guys that you're going to be going up against at that level. So it's kind of tough to fully judge that, but I do think it does show that maybe the Lowell defensive core is better at grabbing those rebounds, but maybe those are the ones that he's giving up in the AHL where he's playing in a team that's not as good as he is. And I think that if you saw that the last couple of years, like, they had 2 fantastic goaltenders, Doug Carr and Sean Hellebuck, but they built the team around defense and making sure that the goaltender didn't have any spectacular saves all the time. They made the saves that they needed to make, like, for the most part. And it's just, they really built their core around it. Mm-hmm. They just keep it so much.
You mean, you know, that's a lot. Well, you know, a lot of people saw like Kaplan coming out. The defensive core is great. Right?
Yeah.
I believe this is the team belief in their defensive core. It's not exactly that, but so we were trying to, but I was thinking that one of the things that was defensive core was a good goaltender.
Mm-hmm.
Hard to tell, but if you can, our defensive core, defensive team, and you have great goaltending, was that a matchup because of those two things?
Yeah.
When they go to the professional rank, the team doesn't have as well as a kind of score.
Mm-hmm.
And give up 5 goals. Oh, you're an okay goaltender. And it's definitely last night with Michigan. Tyler Mott, 4 blocked shots.
Yeah.
I mean, by himself. And they weren't simple, oh, I kicked my leg. A lot of those blocked shots were like sacrificing the body and throwing your body around.
They were
like
doing extremely well. With
all their teams did that.
Yep.
So was Racine last night a good goaltender, or was he just like a great defensive team in front?
I think a little bit of both, I think. Because the Rockets were trying to get down to the net and get those rebounds, but it was tough to get around some of those guys. Michigan was playing a very physical game, and nothing dirty at all. I think it was a very clean physical game. They were doing a good job of making sure that the Rockets couldn't actually push it up of the goaltender's pads and maybe catch a rebound on the other side of them. They were doing a good job of blocking shots, like you said, and A.J. White talked about that a little bit in the press conference last night, saying how it's a little bit frustrating, but you can't really let it get to your head if you're not getting all your pucks towards the net. And they struggled with that for a bit last night. I think they went, maybe the first 10 minutes of the game, they came out on the goal, and Michigan was getting all. So that plays a little psychologically with you when you're not being able to get pucks to the net, but you got to be able to move past it. But I think Michigan did a good job of making sure that they're both going to be facing too many shots.
So coming in tonight, Michigan State is 5-4-0 against UMass. The first trip to Michigan after Lowell to Tsongas Center in case of River Dog. The trip to Michigan State. The last game they played, it was 4-1 UMass Lowell again at Michigan State. So it'll be nice to see Michigan here. I'm a big fan, and I'm just going to go on record with saying this, of the two-color team. So you've got green and white. Last night was blue and red, or blue and yellow.
Blue and yellow.
I'm a big fan of that.
Mm-hmm.
Boston University, the red and white. You know, I wish UMass Lowell was just to blue and white. That's it.
Yeah.
Get rid of the red.
They've gone more low towards that.
They've gone a little bit towards that,
but yeah.
I'm a big fan of that, and I'm a big fan of, like, Tampa Bay Lightning and Toronto Maple Leafs.
You also mentioned that you don't mind the black and white with one extra color, like the Bruins.
Correct.
Yeah.
So it's one of those things that it's definitely cool to see. So I like seeing those teams come in here.
Mm-hmm.
See them play. Plus, it's also Michigan State, Michigan. Those teams are known across all sports.
Oh, yeah.
You know, you're talking about football, basketball, baseball. I mean, you just know those teams for all the sports. To see them come in here, see the fans of UMass Lowell who may not follow hockey. Maybe this is their first year following hockey.
Mm-hmm.
See a team like Michigan State come in here. To me, it's really kind of cool.
Definitely.
So UMass Lowell has definitely dominated that game out at Michigan State last year on their trip when they played Michigan. 4-1.
Second night of a back-to-back was by when they played Michigan and
so
Michigan State.
Similar setup as it was last year here.
Yeah, they're coming here.
But last year, UMass Lowell defeated Michigan on their home soil. Michigan beat UMass Lowell this year on their home soil.
Mm-hmm.
It's a little different this year, but it will be nice to see them play that first game. So the first thing they played was 1984. So the 4-5 for UMass Lowell record is back to 84.
Yeah.
So that's back to Division Two.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of like this whole thing coming full circle of UMass Lowell. But that also speaks to how much this program has been from.
Mm-hmm.
It spoke to the fact that Norman Bailey has got the connection to say, we'll come out and see your school, we'll play you at there,
mm-hmm.
You can come out and see us.
Yep.
And
I think they have that set up a lot. Because last year, if I'm not mistaken, I believe when Lowell went out there to play Michigan on Friday and Michigan State on Saturday, I believe BU went out there as well.
Right.
And they played Michigan State on Friday and then Michigan
State. Like,
Michigan.
There's probably a connection. Like Norm called, Parker, I heard up on
their
twin, and said, let's do this whole thing. We're going to do this whole you do that thing. Some schools pay you. The UMass Lowell at the time when they went and played Denver a couple years ago wasn't the elite.
Yeah.
They are now. Well, I wouldn't say that, but I'm just saying, like, they, last year they opened.
They're definitely more prominent than they were last year.
Correct. Denver just paid you Netflix.
Yeah.
Denver said, we'll come out. Michigan, Michigan State, just basically said, you can out, we'll come out.
Yep.
Both teams have to pay for the travel. So it's nice to see that here, see what's going on.
Especially with the when the UCHA expanding into the Big Ten conference too. They only have 6 teams in that conference now, so they need to find those non-conference games to fill the rest of the schedule to make sure that they were more likely to actually fill in and do that to deal with Lowell and Boston University to come out and have those non-conference games.
Absolutely. I think that
Lions here.
Yeah, so it's nice to see that they said, well, with the teams that are tough competition. And that was opened up with some of the stuff this year. I said, what team are you not looking for? Team that
for me?
None of them.
Yeah, I don't know if there's any that.
Isn't it? The Yukon, but this is a conference team.
Yeah, sure.
So it's a Wednesday night, but it's a conference game. So it's nice to see that whole aspect of the whole, teams come in and do that for this year.
Yeah,
sure. A lot of times in the past, you might as well have to travel.
Yeah. It was kind of cool to see this year we'll also have the Penn State community really new programs. That'll be pretty cool.
So the Lions are officially out, but we have them like in front of us. It looks like, I mean, Norm Bazin changes things up a little bit. It's a little different than any other schools. There's normal schools. And the line chart and get it in the press box. They lift the goaltender from the bottom or the right or whatever. And first goaltender. Norm Bazin likes to do that in the center goaltender. Or at least 99.9% of the time that's the time. Well, tonight Kevin Boyle looks like he's in the center of the goal for the line chart. So whether or not he gets the start, we'll know when the team comes out to practice.
He's usually going to watch out for the warm-up.
And warm-ups happen 40 minutes before the game?
About somewhere around there. It's 45 to 40 minutes.
So we should be still on the air, so we might be able to let you know if we search both in tonight as they come out. A little bit of change up on things. Gage Ho, is playing tonight. Gage Hammerhoff is getting a shot tonight. That's really nice. Jack and the line. Edward is back there. So a little bit of change up.
Chris Forney will make his debut tonight in defense.
Oh, well.
Looks like we'll be skating online with Jake Cooter.
You're not doing it for game, huh?
Oh, okay. So we're definitely a little bit changed, a little bit different aspect tonight. I mean, again, I'm still sticking with one of the other goals.
Yeah, you never know. He sometimes tries to shake him up.
So I like the fact that Jake Gamer is exactly how much a plan.
Yes.
Playing this game seems pretty cool. I'm still waiting the right thing shortly. That camera, brother,
oh, yeah. It almost happened against Boston College, too. I believe it was. There was one quick play. Cameras was playing deep into the board, then he tried to get out in front to his brother in front, and the goaltender for Boston College, Beth Demko, just made a good sprawl, and he wasn't able to get it past the track. It almost had that moment in their first game ever actually playing with each other on the same team, at least. And professional at the collegiate level. And almost connected in that first game. That would have been an even better story, but we never knew. There's plenty of chances that it could happen.
That's kind of a story.
There hasn't been, like, it's early in the season we have a lot of consistency. You do want to play some younger players with a lot of other guys and see how they match. You want to find that good line chemistry to see who's actually going to be playing a lot of moving forward. So far, it's the only line that I've really seen somewhat consistently is A.J. White, Evan Campbell, and Terrence Wallen. And they've done well so far this season, but they're broken up tonight. White and Campbell are still standing with each other. Looking at Robert Brinson, who has had a good start to the season, so we'll see what that line can bring. So that's a fun thing.
And you touched on that with Kevin Boyle, Robert Brinson. Citizen Fuentes. But is it odd or ironic the fact that Kevin Boyle is the first team to see him in the game Robert Brinson put in?
Yeah, sure.
And they're both transfers, but like, oh, let's do well because we can spin the whole season.
Oh, yeah.
Last year, let's do some well. Home to a great start.
Yeah.
And they just, you know, flatline after that. Is it that, or is it just that last time was an awkward game, a weird game, like ironic, or anomaly
yep.
of what the season is like? It's hard to tell.
Let's see what they bring to the table tonight.
But we're here on MilkweedSports.com. We're at MCS Live Faceoff. We're kind of like previewing tonight's game and recapping last night's game, talking a little bit of college hockey here on MilkweedSports.com. I'm Justin Soderberg. I'm joined by Greg Celona. Follow us on Twitter at MCS Live Radio, MilkweedSports, and at MCS underscore hockey, as well as G underscore Celona and JM Soderberg. You can follow us on Twitter and we have updates on the game, different things to see this. Greg does a lot of Boston Bruins things throughout the season as well, since he's a Bruins fan. You know, follow him and get some updates on Bruins. You know, Tara, that what, 46 weeks looks
yeah,
like.
Yeah, unfortunately.
Our writer, Matthew Chase, that Chase, he wrote a nice piece on that earlier in the week about how we are a little, couple days ago, about how it should be out with it, which is really great going to play back. We're going to put all into that, but it's just a little interesting to see. And a little thing to say.
Maybe it's when Shawn Hutcheon.
Yeah, he might have an input on that, actually.
Yeah, a little bit of
what?
Yeah, I think he had like a little bit of input on that. Like we were talking about the future. If he becomes fine, he can offer it soon.
Absolutely. And he'll talk to us at some point.
Yeah.
Always here on MilkweedSports.com. If you want to tune in, tell your friends. And we'll be here at about 6:30 tonight. And we'll stick with it.
Riverhawks are your 2014 Hockey East Champions. Hey, UMass Lowell hockey fans, season tickets for the 2014-15 campaign are on sale now. Marquee opponents Boston College, Michigan, Michigan State, and Penn State highlight the home schedule as your Riverhawks look to defend their back-to-back Hockey East Championships. Visit GoRiverHawks.com for information on season ticket discounts, benefits, special events, and so much more. Riverhawk Hockey, united in blue.
Tonight's broadcast on ESPN Riverhawk Radio Network will start at 7 o'clock. Or I think this is 6:30. Did they do a pregame show? I believe they do a pregame show.
I think they need to start 6:30.
At something. Yeah. I believe I have a mental alumni update on this night.
Yep.
Very monotone. Very 12:40 at 1 o'clock in the morning update. probably had a few beers in me. But we'll, you know, it's an update. It gives you what you need. End of story, okay? I don't want any more bitching about it.
Yeah.
We have a update every broadcast. So every Friday night, Saturday night, whether it's a game or not. Or home.
Yep.
There's a broadcasted update. You can listen in between 6:30 and 7 o'clock, the pregame show they had. We have about a minute update about what UMass Lowell Riverhawks is doing in the professional ranks. Whether it's the overseas, North America, NHL, AHL, all that stuff.
Yeah.
So you can tune in and listen to that. You can also listen to the broadcast with Bob Ellis and Jimmy Connolly, both award-winning hockey, award-winning sports reporters. Been doing it for many years. Jimmy Connolly, I believe, is in the second year he worked at UMass Lowell after Chaz Scoggins, the Lowell son, retired and moved on. Jimmy Connolly took over from USCHO.com.
Yeah.
Excellent, excellent writer. Excellent broadcaster. So you can tune in at 7 o'clock ESPN Radio. It's 900 a.m. and I believe it's from 1200, probably 80 or something like that.
It's only 980 in the
You can go to ESPN Riverhawk or ESPNNewHampshire.com and listen online as well. Go Riverhawks.tv. You can watch the game tonight, as well as we're going to have a live blog that do scoring updates, penalty updates, different updates from the game. And we'll have a post-game story posted on the website you can read up on. We'll leave Chris Graham might be taking some pictures for us tonight. We'll have some photos of tonight's game as well. So we have a full coverage of U.S. Lowell Riverhawks hockey here at UMass Lowell at the Tsongas Center for homecoming weekend. It's a pretty fun thing. I saw outside, it was pretty cool looking. There's a bunch of things going on.
Yeah, there's almost like a carnival going on. There's lots of things set up.
A bunch of people. It's the first year they call it the homecoming weekend. It used to be Family Saturday or Family Day or something like
family
that.
Family Day.
But it's pretty cool. It's a lot of stuff going on, and
there
was a lot of different things happening. I believe in the next few minutes, we'll be joined by Shawn Hutcheon, who covers the UMass Lowell Riverhawks for the Lowell Sun. Does the Riverhawks blog for them, as well as stories, game stories, and different updates from the Riverhawks for the Lowell Sun here in Lowell, Massachusetts, as well as he covers the Boston Bruins for the Fourth Period magazine, Fourth Period on Twitter, at Shawn Hutcheon. He'll give us some update, what he thought about the game last night, thoughts about tonight's game, and the goaltending situation, and all kinds of stuff. It's just Shawn Hutcheon will be here to talk hockey. That's the important part, right?
Yeah, definitely.
So he'll be here. He just arrived. He's setting the computer up for tonight's game. He'll have some coverage as well if you want to follow along with him.
Yeah.
And at some point, we'll have him on. So I think he's actually coming over to something. But we'll have him sit down. He'll talk to us. But, so, you know, tonight's game is a little different. It's a Big Ten opponent, Big Ten challenge.
Yep.
I find that really cool to have this whole conference, inter-conference, like, match up almost like tournament throughout the regular season.
Yep.
It's not additional. So, that's why two tournaments going up, one in January, or December, one in January, I believe. They're back-to-back. Like, they're both. I don't know. I have to look at
that. I'm not certain.
One's in December for sure.
Yes.
And then the other one, I believe, is in the first season.
I think you're right. That's when they go to Minnesota.
They're playing the Mariucci Classic.
All right.
Holiday Classic. Holiday Classic in Connecticut. Bridgeport, Connecticut. They play against Connecticut.
Merrimack. They're the ones playing in the Mariucci Classic.
Get out there.
Mostly Connecticut.
It's not like it's just a big tournament where it's like you play a tournament, you're done.
Yeah, true.
It's a hockey, Big Ten challenge thing. It's kind of cool. How I think it's just really creative with the fact that they look at the schedule and go, Big Ten hockey, you're playing a lot. Let's do something cool.
Yeah.
And that's how it really kind of got started. But it definitely was something that happened. And it's kind of cool. It's definitely kind of a cool thing. And we've got the WOML here, Bob on our broadcast. So you can tune in to them tonight for play-by-play of tonight's game. What's down? That's a norm base. Yeah. It's a little
Oh, yeah.
I feel a lot of courage. Definitely a great league to be in. It's kind of a cool thing to have. Their Big Ten conference matchup points that make when it's top of the thing. So we have a puck drop in about 70 minutes, 68 minutes roughly, according to the scoreboard number here at the Tsongas Center in Lowell, Massachusetts.
Yep.
Great city of Lowell. And where hockey is back. Right?
Yep.
Right? The hockey is the best. But we puck drop at 7 o'clock. What's cool next weekend?
Yep.
Or the home and home series. We'll be broadcasting Battle Box, the game show, like tonight. Tonight's our first debut broadcast of our pregame show. So it kind of sounds like we're rumbling on here and tumbling on. Bear with us. But next weekend, they're giving us the bobblehead. They're selling as a hockey championship trophy bobblehead.
Yeah.
So the truth of the matter is, Josh Holmstrom holds the championship bobblehead, or the championship trophy is the bobblehead. I know in the past they've given out great roles in bobbleheads. That was really cool. But this is literally someone just like him.
Yep.
So they literally just came in and, he's just now he's playing the ECHL.
Yep.
And now he gets the bobblehead. And it's like, a bobblehead is an enshrinement. History of hockey. If you think about it, there's bobbleheads. I think at the National Hockey Hall of Fame, isn't there?
Oh yeah, I'm pretty sure.
So there's definitely a cool thing about being
made into a bobblehead.
Yeah, it's a cool thing. It's Josh Holmstrom. So.
That's how you know you've made it.
So we're talking college hockey here with Greg Celona, my co-host here at MCS Live Faceoff. Michigan State enters the Tsongas Center for a matchup at 7 o'clock tonight, non-conference matchup, but a Big Ten Hockey Challenge matchup. We got pretty big, something at stake. The Warhawks kind of have to move and rebound from last night. Disappointing, and like I said earlier, impressive loss last night. But we're going to be joined here in 2 seconds with Shawn Hutcheon of the Lowell Sun, who also writes for the Fourth Period Magazine covering the Boston Bruins. We'll talk some more college hockey, and we'll be right back.
Riverhawks are your 2014 Hockey East champions.
Hey, UMass Lowell hockey fans, season tickets for the 2014-15 campaign are on sale now. Marquee opponents Boston College, Michigan State, and Penn State highlight the home schedule as your Riverhawks look to defend their back-to-back Hockey East championship. Visit yourriverhawks.com for information on season ticket discounts, benefits, special events, and so much more. Riverhawk hockey, united in blue.
Yeah, happy. I came up here. I was like, "Where's the water?"
So we're back here at the Tsongas Center. We're broadcasting here live from the press box. I am now joined after Greg had to get back to his duties at UMass Lowell with Shawn Hutcheon, the Lowell Sun, and the Fourth Period Magazine. He covers the Lowell Sun. He covers the Riverhawks. It's hockey team, I guess they have at UMass Lowell.
I believe there is, yes.
Yeah, and then they cover the Boston Bruins, which I think, they were a good team, but then lost some guy last the other night, some guy with a knee, and now they're, okay. He covers for the Fourth Period Magazine, that's Shawn Hutcheon. He joined us for our preview show to talk a little bit of Boston Bruins. We're going to talk about Riverhawk hockey tonight, as well as if you want to touch on some Bruins, we can too. Puck drops at 7 o'clock. We're on the air for another about 30 minutes, and Shawn will join us, or he's here now. Shawn, welcome.
Thank you, Jeff. To be here.
And Greg's gone, so we got rid of it. And, we're just giving him crap. So we barely made it, Shawn. I don't know if you know it. Before the scene that I was talking earlier on the air is that we pressed, connect to our show 2 minutes before the show started because I was a little behind. I get stuck behind some bar counter. So my ear was really talked off. We were talking and talking. And I was getting in the mood, and I looked at my phone, and I go, oh, crap. Got to go home, get the radio stuff, go to the arena. And we made it just in time for the 5 o'clock broadcast. But we're here talking hockey. And, what do you think about last night's game?
Well, I mean, like Coach Norm Faison said, they just didn't have it. You see it right from the start. And they definitely deserved to lose that game. Michigan came out. They were on fire from the very first faceoff. Post-game press conference, Coach Red Berenson, the legend himself, said that was their best game of the season. And it certainly looked like it was. They got better as the game went along.
They executed all their systems perfectly, and Lowell, unfortunately, just couldn't get it going.
And it's the truth. They couldn't get it going. What scares me was that they couldn't get it going in the same sense about the other team getting it going. Like you said, after the game, he didn't really have a, he couldn't come into the press. So they scored one goal. He couldn't go in the press conference and say, hey, this line, our second line, scored a goal.
Right.
Saying, pretty much, he didn't know. Like, I don't know. I couldn't tell you which line was going to score goals.
Yeah.
Last night after the game, he's like, oh, no, I know which line is going to score goals. It's an embarrassing aspect of the UMass Lowell to say, oh, we let a team figure out what team is going to score goals. What line is going to score goals. But in the same sense, if you see rebound, the lack of control in net for Kevin Boyle hurt him finally.
Oh, yeah. I mean, they've played against some very good teams, and of course Boston College. But the benchman really helped out with that. Last night, the benchman didn't help out a lot, and rebound really well. That's the one thing that I think UMass Lowell fans need to get past is, because I heard some comments, and people commented to me today, that, well, he's early into the corner element. Well, you know, I mean, I don't think we're looking at good college goaltender Kevin Brown. But he's nice, Connor Hellebuck, and those are few and far between.
But the truth of the matter is, Connor, we were talking a little earlier, Greg and I, just offhand about who we talked about last night, and about something today, about how was Connor Hellebuck, because the way that Lowell saw hockey is a great defensive core, and the defensive forward, defensive mention, and all that stuff. If Lowell, other five skaters on the ice, make Connor Hellebuck who he was, because it kind of like turned, if you look at his way he's coming to play in the professional game, it's different. You know, I can admit that. It's not gonna relate completely. But in the same sense, as they run through goals against them, double, I think a little over 100%. Doug Carr is giving up 5 goals in the first game. He's not even like he's playing the NHL. He's playing a little lower in the professional game. Because he doesn't have
the
defensive style
of the stuff
in front of him.
I think it's both. I really do. I mean, the last 2 years here at Lowell, we didn't have the big name dimension, but they played as a unit. They played as a unit. They had a great nature in hockey. And so each and every one of them knew their role. And this year, they're still figuring out their roles. And the defensive system, it's more, it's like an NHL system. It's very simple. So defense first mentality, because good defense turns into good offense. But yeah, concerning the goaltending, with Doug Carr and Connor Hellebuck, they're getting used to that next level. Everyone dreams of getting up to the next level, and that's what they are. And they need to adjust to it. Just like freshman theory, that's all they need to adjust to college.
In the same sense, people who ask me things like offhand, walking in the hallways here, to the press room, there's a thing. You hear them murmuring. Like, murmuring things. One of the things is, well, no Paul and Hellebuck, but which is like Connor Hellebuck, or which Paul was there. In the same sense, Doug Carr and Connor Hellebuck, both Doug Carr and Connor Hellebuck when they started the press room. More amazing, the first game as a coach started a guy named Brian Robinson. Thank you. pilot big time, too. So we're here live from UMass Lowell Soccer Center. UMass Lowell and Michigan State coming in to play a soccer match. Big Ten hockey challenge matchup. UMass Lowell lost last night 8-4 to Michigan. But that's what happened. That's what happened. I think about last night. Bob Ellis.
How are you?
So now we'll have a second call. And you can also watch my broker shop.
I might be the only one out there in the entire world of media saying this is not.
Thank you.
pretty well. We have about a minute and a half left. I'm going to say, I've got enough talking time. I don't have to bother with about 30 seconds. Bob Ellis,
UMass Lowell hockey fans, season tickets for the 2014-15 campaign are on sale now. Marquee opponents Boston College, Michigan, Michigan State, and Penn State highlight the home schedule as your Riverhawks look to defend their back-to-back Hockey East Championship. Visit GoRiverHawks.com for information on season ticket discounts, benefits, special events, and so much more. Riverhawk Hockey, united in blue.
Thank you.